that and we'll be back.
So we are going to get started in a minute or two, so find your seat and sit down. Okay, I think we can get started, so let's settle down. And we have some note takers and chapter scribes, Ekaterina Valedina, Karen O'Donohue, and Mohit Sethi. Thank you. And my name is Yariak. I'm the chair of the IETF for maybe an hour more. So we're going to go through the administrative plenary and technical plenary. And when I came here, I think it was Thursday last week, I came to the hotel. The first thing I saw was routing headers in the hotel elevator. And you know, I actually thought we had deprecated them, but you know, maybe this is the SFC working group meeting and they're designing some new ones. It was actually an interesting elevator because it was kind of a multifunction elevator. It was also grading your drafts, or you know, maybe it was my jokes. I always got this elevator. Anyway, so the real program is this. We're gonna have a small presentation from the host. We're gonna talk about updates, not reports, on some hot topics, IETF-wide issues, administrative issues, NAMCOM update, IRTF, just making some changes now. I'm gonna have a postal award announcement. Welcome to the next IETF. We're going to have a very interesting tech plenary on protocols and human rights. I'm going to be doing some thanking of various people, and then we're going to go into open mic for the different bodies here, IAB, IOC, and ISG. And our host in this meeting is Ericsson, and I wanted to ask Gonzalo Camarillo to come up on stage.
Okay, thank you, Yari. Okay, brief host presentation. well, as you know, we announced it the last IETF. It was a last minute thing that Ericsson agreed to host this IETF meeting, and you know, we were happy to welcome you to Chicago. Additionally, also, this was even more last minute. Last Thursday, actually, Yari gave me a call. We were both in Stockholm. And he said like they were having some difficulties finding sponsors for the hackathon. And actually, I mean, open source is right now very important to us. We agreed to sponsor the hackathon as well that happened on Saturday. thank you. And then obviously Ericsson is part of the global IETF host, which means that we commit to support the IETF long term. And so far we've been hosting meetings in Montreal in 2016 and Toronto 2014. So I'm not gonna waste too much time presenting Ericsson because most of you are familiar with that, and otherwise you can actually look it up online. Just to mention that you know we have a global presence. It's you know over 100,000 employees. Maybe the only interesting thing here is that we have over 60,000 people that they are basically service people. So in that sense, we operate a lot of networks for our customers. And I already mentioned that actually in Toronto, that we are probably you know the largest network operator in the world, if you take into account all the networks we manage, actually. But let me focus. I was asking some of you, actually, you know, what would you be interested in a brief host presentation. And as you know, I mean, there's this IASA 2.0 discussions. We just got out of the meeting. So they were asking me basically to explain very quickly why Ericsson is interested in hosting an IETF. So let me explain that. By the way, before I forget, I would like to ask to actually thank Suresh. Well, you all know him. He's serving as area director right now. He has helped a lot with hosting this meeting. So thank you very much, Suresh. Yeah. Okay, so the relevance of the IETF to a company like Ericsson, usually people think in terms of interoperability and kind of, you know, specific technologies, but I wanted to step back a bit and say that the reason why we find the IETF very relevant is basically because of the global community. So as I said before, we are a company with a global presence, and the global community and the global ecosystem that basically is formed by the IETF is extremely important in terms of industry alignment. And industry alignment basically is important not only in terms of technical interoperability, but also in things like, you know, risk management when it comes to investments in R&D and things like that. So in that sense, you know, before going into specific technologies that Ericsson is interested in, I would like people to think in terms of, you know, building a global community of partners, customers, understand that we are doing something that, you know, the community finds valuable for, you know, I mean, not only customers, but people basically providing ancillary services and things like that. Then specific technologies, I have a few slides on that very quickly as well. And then governance. We also find the IETF a good venue to work with because of the governance. It's a very good example of the nowadays called multi-stakeholder, you know, approach or whatever you want to call it, of having, you know, all the basically relevant communities, you know, making decisions. So that's actually quite good. And also something we appreciate from the IETF is the stable administrative and financial support. As I said, I mean, we are very happy to see the IASA 2.0 discussions happening so that everything is clarified. And basically, you know, we ensure a good, you know, administrative support for the IETF. So moving on to the specific technologies that, you know, we find basically interesting in the IETF. Last time I was here in Toronto, I was talking about, you know, IMS, Internet of Things. Not surprisingly, nowadays 5G is basically, you know, the core of our strategy. And coming from Ericsson, you should be surprised about that. And I have divided basically 5G in three parts. First is radio. As you know, there's going to be a new radio interface in 5G. But, you know, those are things that the IETF usually is not so much involved with. The second point is the core network, and the third one is applications. And let me talk very briefly about the core network. We were having we usually have every IETF, the 3GPP IETF meeting. So, you know, engineers from 3GPP coming here, they bring requirements, they basically work with working groups. And just as a heads up, we're gonna be getting at the IETF a lot of requirements coming not only from 3GPP, but from, you know, open source communities, from, you know, many basically players in that ecosystem regarding to 5G. Traditionally, you know, 3GPP, for example, has been working more with what is nowadays called the art area. But nowadays, this is going to be about routing, about operations, about internet. So that's going to be actually quite exciting to work with them. At the art area, we have a lot of experience working with those organizations. Maybe other areas, they have been doing less work. And we are trying to involve basically all the relevant, you know, area directors, IAB, et cetera. So we are excited about, you know, that work coming to the IETF as well. So having said that, let me give you also two brief examples of the types of things that we intend to do with IETF technologies in a 5G context. So the first thing is network slicing. One of the big things in 5G is network slicing. Some people love it, some people hate it. Very different people have different views on what, you know, network slicing is or what should be. But anyway, just examples of work very relevant from the IETF could be, you know, the service models, both layer 3 and layer 2, and all the traffic engineering things, including, you know, the interfaces between the service orchestration and the SDN controllers, and between the SDN controllers and obviously the access networks and the core network. If we go there, obviously, talking about traffic engineering, you know, young models, extremely important as well, and anything that is related to basically how to assign resources with all those, I mean, to all those network slices, and how to manage the network. If we move to the data center, actually, there, we see a lot of open source communities actually playing a key role. So in that sense, some of them, they use IETF technologies like, you know, service chaining or how to basically build underlays and overlays. But you know, it's also very important basically from our point of view. You will see things also from other SDOs like OpenFlow and things like that. So not only IETF technologies, but still very relevant to us. And one last example is basically the virtualization of the core network. So in 5G, all the core network, the telco core network, is being virtualized. And the result is like we have a lot of functions talking between them. And you need basically, I mean, the impact you have there on networking is huge. So you need actually deterministic, bound like things like delay, jitter, and stuff like that. So all the work that happens also in the IETF regarding deterministic networking is also very important. So just, you know, to wrap up the talk, since, you know, host talks, they should be brief all the time, very relevant to what Ericsson is doing. We want to thank the IETF community for all the work he's doing. And I hope that basically this helps also a bit with the work also in the IASA 2.0 working group of basically articulating the value proposition of the IETF. There's a lot of talk about funding, and we need to really have an elevator pitch and actually more than that in order to attract more funding. And lastly, to conclude, on Thursday, we have the Thursday speech, this speaker series. And actually, you know, following up on the 5G issue, we were thinking of something that could be of the interest of the IETFers. Last time we did, you know, 5G requirements when 5G was starting. So this time, John Matson, one of our security experts that probably you know because he's quite involved in the security working groups, he will be basically going through how security has been evolving since, you know, 1G, 2G, 3G, actually ending up in 5G, and what are the security actually mechanisms and the threat models that we are basically using in order to design the 5G system. So I hope that you find that talk interesting. Tomorrow at lunchtime, I'm not sure the room, but probably you can find it on the IETF page. So that's it from my part. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Gonzalo, and thank you for your support. We could not organize these meetings without the support of the host and the global host and all the other sponsors. And thank you also for your interest in the technologies that the IETF is working on. We have a small plaque for you. Okay, so what we're going to continue with is talk about a few IETF-wide topics, and this is going to be really briefer than usual because we delivered an extensive report, I think, what the ISG and chair had been up to. So I'm just going to talk about the meeting and participant numbers a little bit, give our usual update of the professional behavior rules at the IETF, and then talk about some notable process updates and IASA 2.0 work that's been ongoing, some recognition, and some sad news. So in the online report, which you can find from the materials page or from this link if you click on the PDF, talks about notable events during this meeting and what working groups we created or closed and what things we are considering. New mailing list that you might be interested in, even though they're not in the IETF process per se, as BOFs yet, and many other topics, so do check that. We also have similar reports from the IOC and IAB. IAB actually was the first one to start doing this style of reporting, so thank you for that. And we have reports from the RFC editor, Secretariat, Ayana, and also, there's a chair's blog, or it's a sort of a collection of IETF people writing different things, not just the IETF chair. So we try and make some kind of updates there pretty much every week or a couple times a month at least. So do follow that. The meeting and the participants. So we have, as of, I think, last night, 1,086 people on site, 183 first-time attendees. IETF 95, which was in Buenos Aires, had 1,043 people on site. So we were above that. I think we might have been a little bit more than 1,086. We're hoping to get 1,100 and some, but a bit below that, but a good turnout nevertheless. 57 countries, which is also a good number. Most from the US, obviously, some from Canada, and some from China, and the rest is quite diverse. Professional behavior, I did want to say something about this. I think we'll keep saying this in many of the meetings, just a reminder, and particularly if there's some new people around who haven't seen this before. So you know, please remember to be professional and nice when you are discussing topics on either in the working groups or live or in the mailing lists. We also have various documents indicating how we should be operating and what to do if we're not operating within those parameters. We have an IETF code of conduct document, IETF anti-harassment policy. We have a BCP for dealing with harassment cases. We also have a so-called ombuds team that you can contact if there's any issue that you might be worried about. And the ombuds team members are actually here. Pete, Linda, Alisa, maybe you can stand up just in case. Thank you. So these are very nice people. Do contact them if you have any concerns.
So there is a question on Jabber from Avri. Any idea on the number of remote participants?
I don't have the number of the remote participants. We can send some information either later, or I'm not sure if Leslie or Ray will have that in their data set, or maybe they can dig that up. I don't have that number. Notable process updates. You may have seen some discussion for a lengthy amount of time on IETF IPR rules. This is not a revolution of those rules. We clarified them in some aspects. And they were approved by the IST a couple of weeks ago. So that RFC is going to be coming out at some point. We also have a clarification regarding the 2119 language. If you haven't seen that clarification, do check that draft. We also have a number of working groups working with GitHub style of interaction, storing drafts there, and even having some of the issues and discussion there. We had this week a working group, the WOOF, I don't know how to pronounce that. There were multiple options, something about dogs maybe, I don't know. So they had a discussion about how we go about using GitHub in our work and you know what things to learn from from the working groups who have been doing this and how their practices can perhaps be improved. The IST also approved a sort of a license file that you should be using if your working group is running in GitHub and have drafts and issues and whatever else there. Do check that. And there's also a template that you can use from Martin Thompson. It's to easily set up this structure with the right boilerplates and such. And also wanted to note that this week several working groups have been meeting with a new meeting format. This picture is from the Think to Thing research group that I personally participated for a bit. And at least from my perspective, that seemed to go really well. It was very interesting in the different corners and very, very interactive as opposed to the usual presenter in the front mode of operation. And for the rest of the week, from tomorrow until Friday, we'll be having one of the meeting rooms, the VV 12, in a U-shape configuration with a little bit more microphones. So hopefully that'll make the discussion a little bit more active and, again, not so much speaker versus the rest of the room format. And it would be really nice if you told us how these things went and if you liked them or didn't like them. Also a little bit more generally, the IST identifies many issues as we discuss our work. but not everything. So if you think we, the IST, should be doing something, consider some topic or provide some guidance, or if we've not done something in the proper way, we should do it some other way, tell us. Tell the new IST. I won't be there. And then IASA 2.0. So IASA is the IETF administrative activity, and it's a setup that has been in place for 12 years. It's has served us well, I think. We've had successful meetings, and our finances are roughly in order, and so on. We can do things that we need to do, but in the meantime, the world has also evolved quite a bit. Leslie Daigle, who was participating in one of the meetings, the meeting on the IASA 2.0 today, said that she had participated in the early beginnings of that, and now is part of the IAOC. Those two setups are very, very different 12 years ago and then now. And so the world has changed. We do a lot more at the IETF today in terms of our administrative activities, and the new or the existing structures may not be optimized anymore for what we're doing. So we've been discussing this. We had a couple of workshops in February, March, if I recall correctly. We have a new mailing list you can join. We had a meeting just before this plenary to discuss, and there actually seemed to be, or my read of the situation at least, was that there was appetite for reorganization of these activities to better suit today's IETF. So that's good. Look forward to that. So we're discussing things like structure, funding, transparency, staffing, and other resources. There's a document that talks about some of the feedback that we've gotten so far before this week. And the discussion is going to continue on the list, and probably we're going to be organizing some workshops in this space going forward. So we're not creating a new working group at this point, but some workshops. So do follow that. That's important. I know it's just something that has to work, but it's also important. I have one piece of recognition here that I wanted to alert people to. So Mars Abolio has been the person who has organized big parts of our meetings. Her first meeting was at the IETF 31 in 1994. And IETF 98 will be her last meeting, as she's retiring to spend more time with grandkids. And I think that sounds lovely, and we'll manage, I'm sure, somehow. I'm not sure exactly how, but just wanted to say thank you, Marsha, for all your work. Thank you. Unfortunately, we occasionally also get some sad news. And I have two persons here that we have lost recently, Andrea and Sharon. Andrea was working in the TCP Inc. working group, among other things, and Sharon in the PKIX working group and with X509. And I think it would be appropriate for us to hold a moment's silence to remember these persons. Thank you. So with that, that's my report. We're going to go to the rest of the agenda. So I'm going to ask Leslie and Ray to come up first.
Thank you, Yuri. So this is the time for us to give our thanks to folks who are assisting us in these meetings. One is the IETF global host, Ericsson. Thank you very much. Suresh and Gonzalo, thank you. We have gold, silver, and bronze sponsors of this meeting, Akamai.ca and Cable Labs and VeriSign. Thank you very much. Welcome reception, Huawei. Appreciate it. Came through at the last minute. Well, we appreciate your coming through. Connectivity of Comcast and AT&T. Thank you, Jason and the AT&T team. And for hackathon sponsors, silver sponsors, Ericsson, and bronze sponsors, Mozilla. Thank you very much. Bits and Bytes, again, Thursday night. We have several companies that are going to be there. You can see them on the screen. And so that's going to be 7 o'clock in the Lucerne Ballroom. You want to be there. So now for the commercial. So the IETF budget for this year is $7 million. And part of that, those funding comes for about $2 million or more in sponsorship. This particular meeting had a target of over $600,000, and we fell short by over $50,000. If you think you would like to, and get all kinds of attention, we have different price points from $10,000 at a bronze level to over $300,000 to be a host. And we have easy payment plans. And this is the guy that's going to get in touch with you if you don't get in touch with him. So Howie Baggett, are you here? Howie must be here. Anyways, a very charming Scotsman. You'll enjoy talking to him. So please get in touch with Howie. We also want to acknowledge all the people that contribute to the IETF in a variety of different ways. We have the Code Sprint crew, which is busy working on us all day on Saturdays, developing tools for the community. And we have other volunteers. We have the NOC working group, led by Jim Martin. There's 15 folks who are in there working, setting up this network and helping operate that network. LineSpeed is the contractor for the network, and led by Rick Alphen. And then we have the MeetEcho team, which does a great job in getting more remote participants into the and attendees at these meetings. So thank you for all of that. Put a face on a name that Gonzalo mentioned earlier for this Thursday Tech Talk. And that starts at noon, so you have a chance to grab lunch before going in there or bring it with you. John Mattson is going to talk on the real deal on cellular security. And now, it's up to Leslie. Thank you.
Great. Just first and foremost, a few updates from the IOC. It's that time of year. I'd like to say thanks to the departing IOC members, including Benson Schleser, whose term is ending, and Andrew and Yari, whose ex officio terms are ending. And welcome to new members, Kavi Ranjbar and Ted Hardy and Alyssa Cooper in their respective ex officio roles. Also, yes, thank you. And I'm standing here because I apparently got reelected as IOC chair. So moving on to important stuff, as Yari mentioned, we do have a long form report with more of the detailed numbers, so on and so forth. Yari referenced it. It's in the meeting materials. You can find it at these links. It's pretty hard to escape. We'll be happy to take any comments on that during the open mic period as well. Focusing on a few items that really deserve some airing here. One of the questions that we are focused on right now is meetings and where to have them. Inescapably, we're looking at the impact of upcoming meetings in the US because of changes in the ease with which various people can get into this country or get back in if they leave. So we are interested in stories of people's experiences coming into the country or planning their travel for this meeting. And also perspectives of people who have concerns about leaving this country and coming back in. We're working on what's a rational way to collect those stories? It will probably be in the form of an online form. So stay tuned for that solicitation of information. Our immediate focus is obviously on near-term meetings. We have a recommendation in hand for what to do with 102, which is next summer, currently scheduled in San Francisco. So we are actively looking for information and working on that, whether that's still a rational plan. Financial results, just to be clear about how we're doing. Last year, 2016, the good news is our expenses were below budget. We happened to be on the positive end of currency valuation changes, so that worked in our favor. But our income was also a little short of target, which is not so good. Really across the board, from paid attendance was down for a variety of reasons, sponsorships were down, and just miscellaneous other sources of revenue didn't meet the mark. That's sort of a very quick overview of the 2016 financial results, which roll up thusly. The Internet Society actual support overall for our activities was just over $2.5 million, which made it a couple hundred thousand dollars more than originally budgeted for 2016. So that's the roll-up summary of the state of our finances from 2016. There are, as I said, more details, more numbers, more information in the long-form report that's posted online. Because somebody asked about the how many online remote participants we have, when this slide was created, we had 266 online participants, remote participants registered from a variety of places, and 90 first-timers in the remote participation process. I understand that since this slide was made, we've actually garnered another 20-odd remote participants and are up to just about 100 first-timers. So that's the data as we have it. And I think that's all I will say for now. Thank you.
Thank you. And next up, we're going to have a NOMCOM report. So Lucy and Peter, can you come up?
So Peter and I are going to be a doubles team here.
All right, so you see before you the list of the voting and non-voting members of the NOMCOM. If any of you are in the room, could you please stand up? I see some of you. Could you give them a round of applause, please? Thank you.
The good news is that we finished all of our primary tasks. You see in front of you a list of the people that we forwarded as nominations to the selecting bodies and who were approved. One kink in the process this time, you will notice the interim AD slot at the bottom. This was our bonus round. After Alyssa was moved into the chair slot, we discovered some gaps in the process and went through the emergency vacancy process, which takes place in a 6-week time frame. So we got a speed session. There were a couple of issues that we flagged for discussion with the community. There are some known areas of weakness that continue to show up in the NOMCOM process. It's a very small leadership pool that we draw from for some areas in particular. Ops, internet, transport. Employer support for participation is not always forthcoming. We have good candidates who withdraw in every session. And clear and distinct job descriptions are probably needed for some of the places where the roles are less understood. The IAOC is an example. Understanding in a given IAB session what skills are needed to fill out the complement sitting on the IAB would also be helpful for the NOMCOM. There are a couple of places where the RFCs are going to need an update. The composition of the ISG has changed. We have the 3AD pattern now, and it isn't, there are some places where the process could fall apart around that 2 versus 3 pattern and filling vacancies. It probably takes a little thought. We also need to document the process for filling a vacancy in an active NOMCOM when we're moving someone within the IASG seat to seat, or ISG to IAB, or IAOC to ISG. The only documented process that allows the NOMCOM to make the selection within the process right now is the IAB to IASG pattern. So the rest of them need to be documented. We also need to account for remote participation in the documents. The NOMCOM has a 3 out of 5 meeting rule. That's an in-person meeting rule. It affects both the selection of the chair and of the NOMCOM. That's probably due for reconsideration. We have a couple of requests from the community. These are also in my notes, which you can find on announce or on the IETF list. You can check to see whether or not you are currently qualified to stand for the NOMCOM or NOMCOM chair using the tool that's listed here. This tells you whether or not all of your registration records are current with AMS. It's probably helpful to know that in any case. You also need to update your profile in the data tracker. If you've changed employment, if you've changed your preferred address, if you had an old address that used to be listed that's gone silent, it's really important to change the status of those things in the profile tool, because when the NOMCOM nomination tool sends out notices to you, it uses your preferred address. We had several that were dead letters. Took a while to figure it out. The other thing you can do is provide feedback to the NOMCOM across the board. Buried in my report were some numbers. Overall, in the entire process, there are about 150 people who actively participate in any part of it, standing for the NOMCOM, nominating someone, accepting or not accepting a nomination, participating on the NOMCOM, providing feedback. That's a very small set of this community, so additional feedback would be welcome. I want to welcome Peter, and I want to say we are now in our standby period. Please do not awaken the sleeping NOMCOM.
Thank you. And next up, IRTF, Allison.
Hi, I'm Allison Mencken. I'm newly the IRTF chair. This is really just a couple of slides about the chair transition. I'm very happy to be stepping onto the broad shoulders of Lars. He did an amazing job as the IRTF chair for the last 6 years. This slide's out of date. He actually handed off the chair dot to me on Sunday. Since 2011, when he started, he's been a major devotee of excellence and the openness and reach, the relevance of the IRTF, partnership with the ISOC and others, really working to make us synergize well with our other organizations. And he is the source of innovations that included the Applied Networking Research Prize and the Applied Networking Research Workshop, which I hope you know about, but I'm going to give you just 2 more slides about that. I'd like to ask the people thank Lars for this excellent 6 years of service. Lars, are you here? Stand up. First off, you're not too late to submit work to the Applied Networking Research Workshop. It's a joint workshop of ACM, ISOC, and IRTF. It'll be on the Saturday in Prague. The deadline is April 3rd, next week. And there's both short papers and full papers to submit. And you could make this a great project by submitting, so please think about doing that. And then the Applied Network Prize is an activity that goes through the whole year with us. We have two of the awardees speaking in every meeting. We've had wonderful talks on routing research topics from Yossi Gilad and Alastair King this time, and you're in luck if you missed it because they're giving the talks again in the routing area open meeting on tomorrow morning. And you'll see announcements for the awardees for the rest. There's a few other slides in there, a report. I'd like you to read it. I'll also be putting a report in the IETF journal so you can find out that stuff. Otherwise, I'm not going to keep talking. But thank you very much, and I look forward to working with many of you.
Thank you. And Kathy, if you can come up and talk about the award.
Thank you, Yari. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm pleased, as always, to be able to announce the opening of the nominations for this year's Jonathan Postel Service Award. It's interesting in this year that the Internet Society is celebrating its 25th year, that John not only was a central and pioneer person for the IETF, but he was also the first member of the Internet Society in 1992. So as we celebrate this year, our 25th, we are both looking back and honoring those in our past. We'll have a Hall of Fame this year, but we also have an activity we're calling 25 Under 25. So that as we think about the 25 years past, we're also looking for the pioneers of the future, if you will. And as I tell the young people, these folks, John among them, were in their 20s. Were in their 20s when all of this began. The John Postel Award was established by the Internet Society to recognize those who, like John, have made outstanding contributions to the data communications community. There is a criteria for this award, which I will get to in a moment. There are the past honorees who are also the selection committee, if you will, for the award this year. The criteria are here on this slide. The nominations are open now. They opened this week, and they will be accepted until May the 3rd. Information is posted at internetsociety.org/postel. And the 25 under 25, you will find nominations also for those young people. And those are open until the 31st of May at internetsociety.org/25. So a big year and an important year for the Postel Award. Please think about this. Nominate people who you believe have made a contribution to the internet community and to the internet. Thank you. Thank you, Yari.
Thanks. And Andre, can you come on stage?
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Andrei. I'm from Cizetnik, from Czech Republic, and I would like to invite you for a next IETF meeting. That meeting will have three hosts, so that's why we are three here. Jason from Comcast and Glenn from NBC Universal. And I think I was chosen because I'm not an English native speaker, so they decided that they will just be silent and I should invite you, which is actually a hard job, I would say, because there's going to be fourth IETF meeting in Prague, so the super majority of you were there, and I think talking about Prague would be just bringing oaths to Athens. So if you don't mind, I will just concentrate on the most important topic of that event, and that's going to be the social event, of course. Last time we were in Kassel on an island in the river, so we decided that it was fine. We will not move far away from it. So we were on the river's bank, close to the Charles Bridge. That's one of the most beautiful parts of the city. It's a restaurant called Hergetova Cihelna, or Herget's Brickyard, if you wish. And it's a really beautiful place. And we decided that it's probably good to have some themes, some topics of this event. So one is pretty natural. This, in the same building as the restaurant, there is a museum of Franz Kafka. So that's going to be a first interesting person who lived in Prague. You will have a free entrance to that museum, so you will be able to enjoy the strangeness of him. And you know, Kafka is hard to understand. His novels are not easy. And the same thing is the Czech humor sometimes. So please don't be surprised if in front of the restaurant you will see something like this. Yes, those two persons are a little bit rotating, right? And the thing they are sprinkling, actually, it's a silhouette of Czech Republic. So as you can see, we are not a very patriotic country. The second person, and I think you will notice his name when you will land in Prague, is Václav Havel. You will land on Václav Havel Airport. You know, he was the last Czechoslovak and first Czech president, a lifetime fighter for human rights and freedom, a very good, great person. I will tell you something you don't know about him, actually. When he was inaugurated as a Czech president or Czechoslovak president, he came in a trousers with short trouser legs, you know. It was quite, you know, Czechs are not exactly the fashion freaks, but it was noticed by everybody that his trouser legs are a little bit shorter than it should be. So when he died, after as his memorial, at the day he died, you know, we all wear short trouser legs. So it's quite, if your trousers will have some problem, don't be afraid. It might be taken as a compliment to a president. And the last person is, of course, medieval, you know, Prague's medieval city. This is Charles IV, Holy Roman Emperor and Czech King of Bohemia, somebody who actually made Prague as a center of medieval Europe. It was in 14th century for the first time. And he founded a lot of buildings in Prague. The Charles Bridge is one of them that you will see very well from the restaurant. He founded Charles University. It's in top 20 oldest universities in the world, by the way, my alma mater. And he also founded a one interesting construction, and it's called, that's a wall. Fantastic wall, actually. This wall was built in the time of famine in Prague. Many people were starving, and since the royal granaries were full of grain, he decided to give the food to the people, but he didn't want to give food for free, so he decided to build this wall. It has no other purpose. It was just a wall to feed people. So that's why we call it Hunger Wall, and might be inspiration for some other constructions in the world, if you wish. So that's the social. I have a few remarks to the end, a few changes. The Czech Republic is currently can be called Czechia as well. We finally have a single name for the country. It doesn't have to be Czech Republic, which is quite long, so Czechia. Another thing, we have some changes in law, and there is a smoking ban in a restaurant. So if you like beer, like me, you don't have to go to a smoked restaurant because there will be none there. So no smoking allowed. One negative thing, that also fireworks are not allowed in Prague anymore, so this time we will not have fireworks. And last but not least, we reached an agreement with Prague Municipality so that every IETF attendee will have public transportation for free. So once you registered, you will get a ticket for free, and I hope you know that Prague transport system is very clean, safe, and absolutely regular, so I think you will enjoy it. So that's all from my side, and again, on behalf of Comcast, NBC Universal, and CZNIC, I would like to invite you to Prague and check the local website, IETF99.cz, for some news. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys. Thank you for your support, and I'm looking forward to it. And next up, we have the technical plenary. So Lee and others, can you come up and start the program?
Thank you, Yari. So the IAB has instituted a technical plenary planning program, and I'm the titular chair of that, although it's been very collaborative. This is really the first technical plenary that we've been able to bring together as a program. I hope you like it, and that's why I'm here to introduce it. What we've done is we've invited two people. Niels Ten Uwer is the head of digital for Article 19. He's also one of the co-chairs for the Human Rights Protocol Considerations Research Group, and co-author of the primary draft in that work in that research group right now. And we've also invited Dave Clark, who is the head of the computer science, wait, I've got it written down. CSAIL, that's the easy way to say it, the Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory at MIT. And his work is cited in the draft, which is part of why we thought that his perspective might be a useful complement. So we're gonna have Niels speak for a few minutes, and then Dave. No, thank you.
Hello, world. Now we're going to talk today about the relation between internet protocols and human rights. And this is going to be complicated. This is not an easy thing. So, but that it's hard has never stopped us from doing the right thing before. So let's get right into it. So, but when we approach a problem, let's first define the concept. So first, what is a protocol? It is a special set of rules that hosts and telecommunications use when they communicate, or it's a system of rules of governing affairs. But we also know that there's a difference between protocols as we document them and as they are deployed and implemented. But this is perhaps something we can actually work with when going down. So let's now have a look at what rights are. And to have a look at that and not give an exhaustive definition, let's have a quick, albeit incomplete historical tour. In 1215, the Magna Carta in Britain, which is maybe relevant today, was an early step at regulating the power between the ruler and the citizen. Before that, the citizens, or rather subjects, could be arbitrarily dealt with as a ruler deemed fit. In 1689, the Bill of Rights regulated the rights and the liberties of people, but in this case not against the sovereign, but vis-a-vis the parliament. And in 1776, there was the US Declaration of Independence, which declared the US independence from the UK, setting their own rights and defining that in their own terms. And that wasn't enough, because in 1789, the U.S. Bill of Rights, which are the first 10 amendments in the U.S. Constitution, specified more specifically personal freedoms and rights with safeguard of liberty and safeguards of justice. And then, in 1947, something happened, because this time it was not about sovereign countries, but countries coming together after the Second World War, coming together and saying, "Never, this never again." And we're going to come up with a set of rules, which are the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was not an international, this was not a legal document, but an aspirational document. But it was the first time that this actually happened. And it then later became international law when it was ratified into the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights and International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. And those three documents together, the UDHR, the ICCPR and the ICESCR, it's not only engineers that are good in abbreviations, together form the International Bill of Rights. But there are more treaties in which human rights are ratified. But then we also understood that it's not just countries that impact human rights. Also, transnational companies and other and large organizations impacted human rights. And that problem was also addressed in the beginning of the 2000s when the UN Global Compact was set up. You may not have heard of the UN Global Compact, but you've probably heard about the term that came from there, corporate social responsibility. Corporate social responsibility was still a relatively vague and broad term. And to build on that, in 2011, the UN Guiding Principles for Business and Human Rights were developed. You might also hear them referred to as the Ruggie Principles, after the lead author of the committee, John Ruggie. And the Ruggie Principles consist of three pillars. The obligation for states to protect human rights, that's an active obligation to go out. For non-state actors, it's the responsibility to respect human rights within their own remit. And the third pillar is the to give people opportunity for remedy in case rights have been breached. But the first step for every organization that would implement the Ruggie principles is to know and to show your human rights impact. So this was a long introduction to rights, but what about rights and technology? So before we go there, let's first have a quick recap. Rights claims are made and standardized to limit arbitrary power and control. But this is also an evolving practice that changes based on context and experience. So let's have a look at how technology changed the world and the rights claims that came with that. So the UN Human Rights Council in 2012 stated that the same rights that people have offline must also be protected online, which is pretty much a no-brainer. But it did show that we needed to think more about this topic because apparently the practicality was not so easy. The question is how to do this. The UN Special Rapporteur for Freedom of Expression gave a few hints in his report in 2016, where he said that commitment to freedom of expression should be integrated in internal policy making, but also in product engineering and business development. So this is where the rubber is starting to hit the road. So, how does this relate to our internet? We've all seen the internet as this huge engine for freedom of expression. And it has indeed enabled us to, it created a wealth of opportunities for people to express themselves and gather information. But that doesn't mean that there are also downsides to this, as we've seen in the case of pervasive surveillance and other downsides that come with that package as well. So what we can conclude is that increasingly our actions are mediated by the internet, ranging from freedom of expression, association, engaging in the public debate, education, and sometimes even voting. So this is a problem that we've been trying to research and map since July 2015 in the Human Rights Protocol Considerations Research Group. This resulted in draft IRTF HRPC Research 11, which now has, which is a research group consensus document and which will soon will be submitted to the IRSG for review. So it's an important moment to think about this with internet playing an increasing role in all of our lives. But we also need to consider at the same time that the internet access to the internet is not equally distributed to the rest, to the whole world. So how global is our internet really? We have here in the IETF greatly contributed to the shaping of the internet that we have today. But with great power comes great responsibility. And this is a call to assert that responsibility. But luckily, we do not need to start from scratch. we have some statements on which we can latch on in the RFCs, such as RFC 3935, a mission statement for the IETF, which says that the internet isn't value neutral, and neither is the IETF. It says that it wants the internet to be useful for communities that share our commitment to opportunities and fairness, that we embrace technical concepts such as decentralized control, end-user empowerment, and sharing of resources. And that these concepts have little to do with technology that's possible, but to do with the technology that we choose to create. That has set the intention, but it hasn't given us sufficient understanding of the relation between technology and human rights and how adverse human rights impact of protocols might be mitigated. So one thing we do know is that there is an ongoing interest from other actors to use protocols as a means of control. If we do not think about this problem in the IETF, there is the risk that other people might address this for us, which would set us at the back foot. Good work has been done, though, here, as I said before, that we can build on, such as the ongoing work on a security considerations documents and the security considerations in all our protocols. We have the guidelines on the privacy considerations. We have other statements that go really far, that have dealt with this issue in detail. But what about other rights, such as the freedom of expression, freedom of association, non-discrimination, political participation, education, and the right to participate in cultural life, arts and sciences, and others. So, in order to come to grips with this, we need to understand the impact of internet protocols on human rights. We will need a kind of human rights impact assessment for internet protocols, so we can know and show how our designs might impact human rights. And then we will need to potentially balance human rights that are in conflict with each other. And then document, and then continue with what we're doing good at here, setting the standards. And we can do this. Mankind has been setting standards since Pompeii, and here in the IETF we've been doing it for a while as well. And also in the standard sector, we're not the first ones thinking about this either. The IEEE has a model process for addressing ethical concerns during systems design, which is a standards process. And ISO has ISO 26000, which is a standard on social responsibility. That said, again, this is not easy, because not everything is done by the IETF. It is a complex landscape, we're not the protocol police, and a multi-layered stack and an ever-evolving ecosystem is where we are in. But we need to understand our own role and remit in this, and take that responsibility. This does not mean that our technology is bad, nor that it's good, but it definitely means that our technology is not neutral. Almost 2 years of work resulted in the research group consensus in HRPC. Would it be time to take this work from the IRTF to the IETF, from research to engineering? And what could probably also help the discussion further, to do more road tests with the guidelines and see how these guidelines and these considerations and these human rights impact assessments of protocols would actually work in practice. So if you're working on a document, have a look at the guidelines and report about it, discuss it, because awareness raising is a large part of know and show. That was my part, and I'm greatly looking forward to what Dave has to say.
So let me begin by saying that I've read the draft he's talking about. I greatly enjoyed reading it. I absolutely recommend it as a perhaps diverting digression from something that explains how to use the 32 bits in a header for some new use. And, oh, he said 128. He's reminding me that I come from the earlier generation. I'm sorry, I'm so old. And also, if you think this was a little abstract and you're trying to figure out what our protocols might actually have to do with human rights, there's some very concrete examples in this document that sort of brings this down. I personally found it fascinating to read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. There's some really interesting questions in there, and it's caused me to have some conversations with Constitution. By the way, I don't know how to get my slides up here, so I'm going to talk while somebody else. I don't do Windows. Well, this is a Mac. I probably can do it. For example, one of the rights that's defined in that is the right to leave your country. doesn't say any country has to let you in, but you have the right to leave your country. So that raised an interesting question. Should the same rule apply in cyberspace? The obvious analogy being, should you be able to VPN into another country and be a cyber tourist? And I tried that on several constitutional lawyers who are the ones who are best qualified to think about this, and the answer was no. The analogy does not hold. And there's an interesting reason for that, of course, which is that when you go to another country, you're unambiguously subjected to the law of the land in that country, but when you VPN in, who knows what laws govern you. So there's all kinds of interesting conversations that arise in this space, but I want to say specifically, why am I here? I'm here because in 2005, with some co-authors, I wrote a paper in which we picked a word, and the word we picked was tussle, and what we were talking about was the contention among actors with differing interests to shape the internet to their preferences. And I'm not talking about good guys and bad guys, I'm talking about people with legitimate interests that may be adverse to each other. And the interesting thing about the internet is how this tussle plays out. At the time I wrote this paper, we were just in the midst in Boston of this catastrophic effort to put all of the major highway underground. It's called the Big Dig. And there was tremendous tussle about the Big Dig. Where should the entrance ramps be? What neighborhoods were going to be disaffected? All this kind of thing. But by the time the design is done and they start pouring concrete, the tussle's sort of over, mostly, except when the ceiling starts falling down, but we won't go into that. And the point about the internet is that because of its plasticity, the tussle continues at runtime. And if you just look at what's going on now in response to the movement toward the increased encryption of things, where what you see is people trying to break the encryption by messing with the certificate authority system, you see it's an ongoing process. And so how do you think about that? What we wrote in the paper, and this was a design preference, it's debatable, but what we wrote in the paper, I'm sorry, there's text, but I'll read you the key point. What we advocated was design for tussle, design for variation in outcome so that outcome can be different in different places, and the tussle takes place within the design, not by distorting, violating, or attempting to break it. Don't design so as to dictate an outcome. If you do, the design may break. There's the informal aphorism in this space, which is the tree that bends in the wind doesn't break. Here's another way to think about it. You're designing the playing field, not the outcome of the game. But if you're clever, you can tilt the playing field. And that is the opportunity that you have. And I want to stress, our work is not value neutral. There's a movement. There are a number of people in the computer science community that advocated for this. It's been called the values in design movement. And I strongly believe in this. If you're interested, you might just go Google values in design or values at play and see some of the writings in this space. But there's no doubt we are not value neutral. And sometimes you have to work with people to try to figure out what the values are that they're actually expressing. Now, let's get to human rights. And I think it's actually interesting to read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but I want to bring your attention to, I think it's sub-item 2 of Article 29, which basically says, in the exercise of his rights, that was just after World War II, in the exercise of his rights and freedoms, everyone shall be subject only to such limitations as are determined by laws, solely, notice all the qualifying words in here, lawyers were putting those in, for the purpose of securing due recognition and respect for the rights and freedoms of others and of meeting the just requirements of morality, public order, and the general welfare in a democratic society, which put bluntly means local law trumps human rights. And otherwise it wouldn't have gotten signed. So there's a huge hole here through, several countries have driven a truck through this hole. And, I don't always like some of the things that have happened in this space, but it's important to remember rights are not absolute. And so the question is, when you think about human rights, do you think about it as something that you're going to advocate for in a sort of an absolutist sense? Are you going to recognize that human rights is embedded within what I would call a tussle space? So let me give you a couple examples. You need to think how tussle plays out. It can play out in the courts. It can play out in legislature. It can play out in a larger social context where people use technologies in ways sometimes that you didn't expect. It can be controlled by the choices in how people spend money. It was Alan Kay who said the best way to predict the future is to invent it. And I said, no, Alan, the best way to predict the future is to invest in it. You get what you buy. Or it can be shaped by the use of features of the technology. And designers of technology have a choice. which is what I'm going to call to be in the conversation or out of it. Are you designing the technology such it helps to define the playing field, or are you going to let the game be played by someone else? And I want to offer you an example in this space of an interesting issue which goes back in history a little bit. It's the very first time that the IETF was approached and asked to design standards for lawful intercept, or what's called exceptional access, or informally wiretap. The IETF was invited to design standards that would implement the relevant sections of what's called CALEA, which is the Communications Assistance for Law Enforcement Act. This was around 2000, and the IETF, after some deliberation, declined to do so. And it's interesting to go back and read the document, which I respect. I think the reasoning in the document was quite sensible. But go back to read RFC 2804, otherwise called the Raven process. I'm curious, how many people here remember the Raven process? Oh, I'm so old and you're so young. I'm so sorry. Anyway, the IETF declined for several reasons. They said CALEA is a U.S. thing and we're an international body. There's a whole bunch of reasons in there. But I was recently talking to a policymaker who said, did the IETF actually go read the law? And I don't actually know the answer to that question. Maybe somebody here does. But he pointed out, what? I'm sure you did. Yes, right. Who was that?
Scott Bradner.
Scott, yeah, of course you did. But I want to point out, I know, it was Scott Bradner who's deeply involved in this process. But here's this interesting clause from the law. What it says is, a telecommunications carrier shall be found to be in compliance, blah, 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 if the carrier is in compliance with publicly available technical requirements or standards. That's actually an interesting clause. Now, it's quite possible if you read section 106, which tells you what you have to do, that you feel that there is no space left to tilt the playing field by how you define the standards. Could very well be. But the point is, this is actually embedded in the law, an invitation of the technical community to help define how CALEA is implemented. And the IETF, by declining, in some sense, left that decision to others. It doesn't mean we didn't get standards, it just came from somewhere else. So while I'm saying there were good reasons why the Raven process came out the way it did, it's important to recognize even lawmakers are prepared to understand the role of the technology community as a player in what I'm calling the tussle conversation. Now, I wanted to show you a standard from another standards body just so you can see how other people think about this. This is from 3GPP. You heard about them earlier. Fairly important standards body. And I'm going to read you, because again, this is sort of a small piece of text, I'm going to read you some of the important stuff from this. This working group, which is SA3, will determine the security and privacy requirements for 3GPP systems. It doesn't say how. It doesn't say on what foundation we will determine what security and privacy actually is. Those are aspirational words. They're meaningless until they're made operational. Okay. When somebody says, do you want more security? The answer is obviously yes. You know, it's like motherhood. And so, and they, did you actually know what you just said? Okay. The working group will ensure the availability of any cryptographic algorithms which need to be part of the specification. That's interesting. The working group will accommodate, as far as is practicable, any regional regulatory variations in security objectives and priorities for 3GPP partners. They absolutely acknowledge it's going to come out different in different places, and they're going to try to embed that within their standards. The working group will further accommodate, as far as is practicable, regional regulatory requirements that are related to the processing of personal data and privacy. That has to do with the fact that some countries believe in it and others don't. And I liked this one. The subworking group SA WG3-LI will detail the requirements for lawful interception in 3GPP systems and produce all specifications needed to meet these requirements. So I read this and I say, well, in some respects, I can appreciate it. They definitely acknowledge tussle. They're very clear. I think it's very clear here that they aren't going to let any regional variation keep their products from coming into any part of the world, which doesn't surprise me. There's nothing in here about a foundation on which you might explain what security and privacy might mean. Can you build such a foundation, at least in part, by looking at things like human rights documents? I think you can. You pointed out several important things, expression and so forth. I think these are useful. Is this the right balance? Would the IETF, if they wrote this paragraph, have a slightly different balance in it? I don't know. But that is the punchline. And the reason I titled this talk is Human Rights in the Balance. I strongly support the use of human rights as a foundational value in considering design implication. I think this is fine. But here's the harder challenge. Do we design for a preferred outcome and then let the tussle happen in other places, and perhaps in ways over which we have little control? Do we incorporate into our designs a tolerance for a range of outcomes, some of which we might, as individuals or collectively, not prefer? There are countries that manage their internet in ways that I personally don't particularly like. And the interesting question is, do we try to build a system which keeps them from doing that, which of course runs the risk that tussle will play out in some other way, like, you know, they just turn it off and build something else instead? But I think the most subtle question, and it's a real challenge to the technical communities, are we clever enough to tilt the playing field? I'm done.
Thank you. Looking for confirmation. I think we have about a half an hour for comments and questions. This is the kind of topic that it seems to me that people who are just thinking about it for the first time have sincere and profound opinions that absolutely must be aired. So I'm hoping, I would love to hear folks having questions for either Niels or Dave about what they've described, or even about any of the other prior art in research in the area, what other standard bodies are doing, and preferably, hopefully, some suggestions for the kinds of things that maybe we ought to do. I'm seeing somebody at that microphone first, and it's a little bit dark over there, but I see people approaching there.
So, hi, Dave, this is Scott. We did sort of do what you suggest. We, in the Raven discussion, we encouraged those who had technology for wiretapping to publish them as RFCs, not standards track, but to say what the playing field looked like, and right, so that they could be checked, and they could be examined for flaws, et cetera. And we've got a few. We've got a few as part of that. And that's part of 2804 as well.
Right.
So it was not an easy discussion. We had people who thought it was a moral sin that governments wiretapped. And we got people who said that it's government's responsibility to do so. So it was a political discussion masquerading as technology.
Yes.
Mia Kuleman. Oh, sorry. Do you want to answer? So I think I should go and read the document from the Human Rights Research Group. But just for the context of this discussion, can you maybe give some example what the guidelines are that are in this document?
Yes. Let me pull up the latest version. We have the one thing is we have more than we wanted. So that is so this is why I think this is something we know. It's the what we did is we started a rogue test with three actual protocols and see and saw what would be useful to use, because we had many more guidelines, and I think to make it useful, we need to have a kind of a decision tree and see, like, this is relevant so you can dig into deeper. Because there is no such thing as automating this process, because it's also always very dependent on context. That's why I think what Dave said was really correct. We cannot say, this is where it's going to go, because we cannot predict how protocols are going to work and not even how they're going to interact together, right? But there are things we can think about, like, will this protocol make censorship harder or easier? And on what level? Will it be transparent? What impact will this have on privacy? What will does this protocol allow for internationalization? Does it have an impact on anonymity? But also accessibility, localization, decentralization. All those kind of things are things that you can think about. But this is not an exhaustive list. So what we did is that we, in the development of this draft, is that we went through different protocols. We did interviews, but there are of course a lot of rights that we probably haven't dug out sufficiently. And right now we're continuing a new draft on freedom of association and seeing how the internet impact association and assembly, because we've seen that we think that using DDoS as a kind of political speech is not a good thing, because it harms the infrastructure and there also limits the freedom of speech of others. But are there ways in which it does enable or inhibit it? So this is these are things that we are thinking about, and we currently have 19 considerations, and we would be very happy to see, does this make sense? Do we need more? Do we need less? Or is there another model in which we can do?
Can I follow on? And in the example protocols you looked at, did you find something that was missed at the first place and now is added because of this work you've did?
So there definitely have been, the two testers was Giovanni Mura and Shane Kerr said that they were definitely useful and they made changes while drafting. So that was already a little success story.
Yeah. Paul Hoffman, Dave, you asked the question, can we tilt the playing field? And the answer is yes, we can. The better question is, can we do it well? At various times, at various plenaries, political things come, you know, actual political things come up. And we here normally laugh at legislators and judges about their technical inability. They probably would laugh at our political inabilities. I'm one of the people here in the room who doesn't have a CS degree, even though I did go to MIT. I have it in political science. So I know something about politics, and I know how hard it is, and I know how easy it is to get wrong. So before we say, yes, let's tilt the playing field, especially because we might tilt it on two angles at once or something weird like that, let's actually think whether we are a good group to do this or not.
I think it's on.
Is it on?
Yes.
I fully agree with you about the difficulty of doing this. I think the real point is that it does require a conversation among people with different skills. And it is very important in this space to listen to people who bring different perspectives, social perspectives, legal perspectives, moral, ethical perspectives. So we may not be the right group unilaterally, but I think we should. I would say we should try to be very much to be part of that conversation. And I think figuring out how to have that conversation, what group it should be, and so forth. When we, you know, the NSF has sponsored a program over the last several years to ask what the internet of 15 or 20 years from now might look like, just to get people to think freely. And we call this Future Internet Architecture Project. And they actually invited a bunch of social scientists to sit in our meetings and critique what we're doing. And whether that went well always, having those perspectives in the room was fascinating. And by the way, those people were intrigued by the nature of the conversation as well, because we kept saying things that were completely incomprehensible to them. And that was
and
fine.
Them,
was
us,
good.
Probably.
So, well, yes. So yes, who are the people in the room? How do you do this conversation? And these are really important questions, and I don't mean to minimize them at all.
Niels, do you want to follow up?
That other people, such as lawyers, judges, legislators, and the public opinion and the market is thinking about ethics doesn't mean we should not. We cannot outsource our ethics to others and hope that they will take care of it. So, but that also means we're not going to replace them. We should just, within our little remit, take our responsibility.
Work with them, as David was saying. Yeah, great. Thank you.
My name, Pete Resnick. I wonder, looking at what we did with pervasive encryption, I thought it was a cute trick. We reduced the problem to an engineering problem. We said, we don't want to design protocols that allow for pervasive encryption because, pervasive monitoring, thank you. You heard what I meant.
Yes.
We don't want to allow protocols that allow for pervasive monitoring because, in effect, any pervasive monitoring reduces to an attack. It's the same as just another security hole, and it's impossible to tell the difference between so-called good monitoring and the kind that bad people would do. I wonder if that's sort of a good path for an organization like ours is to always look for those, reduce it to an engineering problem where there's an embedded principle and an important ethical principle, but we don't want the entire engineering organization to be constantly trying to wrestle with ethical problems.
We should take more comments.
Okay. Hi there, my name is Andrew Sullivan. In both the research group draft and the Tussle paper, I've always struggled with a question about whether the value of the technology itself is an independent value or whether it's purely instrumental. That is, does it entirely serve the humans who make it, or does it have its own logic? John Calkin said one of my favorite aphorisms is, we shape our tools and thereafter our tools shape us. And I'm wondering whether there's room here to think about, you know, the value of the network itself, which I think probably is just involving more connectivity or something like that. But it seems like it has a kind of independent value that can play in these tussles. And I wonder whether there's room for that or whether this is just a ridiculous idea.
Anybody need to respond?
I'm mulling that over. I'm not sure I've completely internalized it. I think the network as an artifact has brought tremendous value. I'm struck by the fact that I actually had somebody say to me the other day, you know, there's so much bad stuff happening on the internet, do you think it was worth doing?
Ooh.
And that tells you how some people are thinking about it. Okay. And I was deeply distressed. I obviously deeply disagreed. But the fact that somebody could say that, he wasn't joking. Did you really think it was worth doing? Maybe we'd be better off if we'd never done it. The fact that somebody wanted to address that question is, I think, the flip side of the... But it definitely means the question you're asking is part of what we have to address. So.
I think it's trying to deduct what values the system has. I'm not sure... that might be a long way around into simply asking what our values are. Because if you're saying our values are embedded in the network, and then the network shape us, then you're saying that the internet is a techno-social ordering of reality, right? So I think it's very hard to think of it as an independent entity. So the approach to go through network values, I'm not sure how much it would help us solve the problem, but I'm happy to give it more.
Can I just say one more thing about that? If you go back to the very early days when we didn't know what we were doing at all, as opposed to now, there were three of us wrote a paper called the End-to-End Arguments. And that paper has been cited as a foundational argument in favor of all kinds of things, network neutrality and openness and so forth. And I'm a strict constructionist about that paper. If you go read the paper, what it's about is building a system that works. There's a correctness, there's a very simple correctness principle in there, and the correctness principle is, since the network doesn't know what the semantics of the application is, the semantics have to be validated by the code that knows what the application is, which runs in the end nodes. And there isn't anything in that paper about openness, there isn't anything in that paper about values. I think we often design things, certainly back then we were designing things where we were not at all able to articulate how these might play out in a larger space. And I'm actually a little uncomfortable when people attribute more to that paper than it actually says. Now, maybe we're better now. I hope we're better now. I think we should try to be better now. That's the point of the values and design movement, which is to say, try to do this. And by the way, they have some teaching practices where they try to help you learn how to do it. But I certainly think the network we built expressed values that at the time, I mean, Vint would disagree with me, but I would say the network we built at the time came to express some values that we could not have properly articulated at the time.
All right, we're going to move along.
All right, Alistair, I was around for the Raven discussions. We will tilt the playing field. We have no choice. So the only choice we can have is to try to predict which direction the playing field will tilt once we jump around on it. We will often be wrong, But the only choice we have is whether we try or not to try. We have the law of unintended consequences. I mean, there's a regulation that says, okay, radio should not transmit outside certain boundaries, which the FCC turned into a rule saying Wi-Fi access points need to be protected against being set to parameters outside what the country they're sold in, which the manufacturers turned around and said, thou shalt not hack your access point. This was bad for a number of things, including security and the freedom to tinker and the freedom to repair. But we always have unintended consequences of our actions. But if we try to tilt the board in a direction we want, at least we have tried.
I think that's consistent with your points. Well, go here.
Phil Hornbaker. I was one of the participants in the crypto wars, and one of the things that, looking back on that, I realized was that we spent 10 years designing systems not to be secure, but to defeat Louis Free. And we were continuing with that as our design goal long after Louis Free wasn't even in office. And what we ended up with, in many cases, is security specifications that are unusable, don't work for people, don't work for people who can't configure Linux, don't work for 95% of technically astute people. And I think that what we might need to do is, when we approach these things, we've got to be very careful that we have the needs of the real needs of real users in view, and that we're not using this as an excuse to go on our own little ego trips, which is very easy. I've done that myself a few times, maybe. Well, you know, if we're serious about this and we're serious about liberation technologies, there are people who work on them. And if people come to the mic in a working group session and they're saying, well, this is going to have some effect on dissidents or whatever, have you actually talked to the communities that work with dissidents, who provide technology for dissidents? I have. And I would like other people to do that. Because it's only if you look at it from their point of view that you suddenly realize, well, yes, just throwing encryption everywhere is not solving the problems. What we've got to do here is that we've got to come out with a set of application layer crypto that anybody can use. We just had a failure of email security that tipped an election. And the failure was that a certain grandmother nearing 70, was not able to use end-to-end encryption. And that's because we blew it here. If we had produced a decent, usable end-to-end encryption stack, maybe the result would have been different.
Looking for a response? Okay.
Go on.
Let's go to that mic.
Hi there. I'm Daniel Kahn Gilmore from the American Civil Liberties Union. So I wanted to reinforce what Harald Avrestrand said and kind of push back a little bit on Paul Hoffman and Pete Resnick. We are building incredibly important tools here. They may not be the best tools. I'm sure everybody here has some ideas of things that came out of the IETF that did not end up technically or perhaps ethically as well as they wanted. But what we're building here are tools that everyone in the world is ending up using. While it would be nice to say, let's try to not let the engineers have to think about ethics all the time, and it would be nice to be able to say, we might not tilt the playing field in the right direction, we might not be clever enough, let's just step back. The fact is that we are building the playing field today, and so I appreciate that we're having this discussion here, because it is critically important that engineers, like all of us in this room, are thinking ethically all the time about what the consequences are. And you may not have enough information. And if you don't have enough information, you should reach out and try to find that information. This is the ethical responsibility of our profession. And so I'm really happy to hear that we're having this discussion and acknowledging that we play a role in whether people can exercise the rights that they expect on the internet of today and of tomorrow. So thank you guys for being here and working on this stuff.
Thank you. The Roman roads enabled the Roman pax, and the human rights defined by the oligarchies of Rome, that is, Roman citizens had specific rights and the rest of the world had slavery for non-citizens. Are you saying that the internet, which is a virtual highway similar to the Roman highway that connected the known Western world at the time, should be defined by this virtual society, i.e. the IETF, as an internet virtual technology? Is this one group defining for the rest of the world? Do you feel that we have the rights to do that? I'm questioning the basic premise here.
I don't think I understand your question, because I don't think we should define human rights here. Human rights were a set of treaties that are the most widely shared universal ethical principles, signed by almost all countries. So, and I would not say that we should go out and do something to people, but apply it to our own work and take our own responsibility.
I believe you have a bit of history here. You're pointing to a set of rules from the Western society that you are engaging in as the premise of truth. And I point to another point in history where another group felt they had the premise of truth, i.e. the Roman oligarchy. And at that point, they defined a definition of citizenship for Rome and slavery for the rest of the world. I'm not saying that I'm not saying that freedom's wrong. I'm not saying that the rest. I'm just saying that your premise that you base it on may well take a good look at it. The basis of it is based on some assumptions that may or may not be correct. And I will address this to Dr. Clark as well, because I'm just saying, think deeply when you say across the world you have thrown out national rights, or have you gone above? Because you have defined these rights as above all other things. I'm not saying what's right. I'm not saying what's wrong. I'm just pointing to two situations which are similar. Thank you.
Can I? There's no doubt if you're a cynic about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and I've spoken to a number of people about it, that it reflects a sort of a Western-centric conception of what rights might be. And there are a lot of countries who signed it under the expectation that, well, you know, it's a piece of paper. And that is, I think, again, my political science friend said, how could you possibly think about it any other way? So you're absolutely right that there's no reason to think, if you talk to people from different cultural backgrounds and different deep historical sort of cultural traditions, that they would buy into it with the same fervor that we might. So that is something you really need to be sensitive to, and it's sort of, what is the place of cultural relativism in this whole space? If you look at the internet, there's a fascinating... Technically, if you look at it, there's a fascinating tension between sort of what it does at one layer and what it does at another layer. We absolutely aspired, and I don't know whether this is a Western-centric goal or not, but we absolutely aspired to the goal of generality. That is to say, we wanted to be able to support a wide variety of applications. To a certain extent, that was because we were trying to hook computers together, and computers are general-purpose devices, so the network should be general-purpose. From that perspective,
if it turns out that in different parts of the world, the internet experience is shaped by different applications that people choose to use, it's hard to see that we have any complaint. If there are parts of the world that prohibit certain modes of behavior, we might say, well, let's think about whether or not we would like to push back against that or accept it as a something that's acceptable within their normative structure that we ought to live with. Part of my advocacy for TUSL is basically to say, these considerations need to be balanced. I don't think that a sort of a naive articulation of the rights in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is necessarily the right balance. So that only makes the problem harder.
And thank you, Dr. Clark. That is exactly my point. I just hope you will balance both. That will make it more universal. I do believe the internet has brought great joy because of the things Dr. Clark mentioned. Thank you.
I'm about to cut the mic lines. So this is your warning that if you have been waiting for the lines to get shorter, they are. This is where we are now.
Mike Bishop. So one of the previous people at the mic line was saying that was questioning whether we are the right people to answer this question and to tilt the playing field. And I heard someone behind me say, "Who else?" Well, I wonder how many of us are aware that the IEEE now has an encrypted traffic inspection working group that is considering adopting, or perhaps has adopted, a protocol proposal called multi-context TLS that allows a negotiated third party to look into a TLS connection. I personally think it's exceptionally dangerous that they're doing such invasive changes to TLS without the input of the TLS expert to the IETF. And at the same time, what was that?
Say no.
And at the same time, whenever anybody, that comment was because we'd say no. At the same time, whenever anybody tries to raise some of the arguable use cases for a third party to see what's going on inside an encrypted tunnel, the immediate response is, see RFC 2804, we don't do wiretapping. But I did look at RFC 2804, and the definition of wiretapping is that neither party knows it's happening. And one of their requirements in multi-context TLS is the parties are aware of what the third party is and what access they have. So I don't know that the gulf is that wide from what we've put in RFCs, but there's certainly a gulf between attitudes. And I think if we don't at least talk about it, we're not going to get anywhere.
Mic lines are closed. I'm going to go back, Mike. Nalini, that's you.
Nalini Elkins. I wanted to add a little bit on to what Mike Bishop said, too. There's two things I've really been thinking about a lot. The first, and let me preface this by saying that freedom of speech is an extremely important thing to me, and I have quite often been known as a political dissident. So I will come from that perspective. But two things. First, do we live in a post-privacy world? That is, are our expectations of privacy with what Facebook and Foursquare and everything else that are known about us, is that even something that we should have as any kind of expectation, especially for someone who wishes to engage in dissident political speech? Number two, which is connected, which is, when will the sheriff come to town? If we consider that the internet is the wild, wild west, which in many ways it is, one of the organizational forces for the internet is the IETF. And I very much agree with Dan Gilmore that, and many other people, that there needs to be a lot of values. Having said that, will there be a precipitating event such that someone, law enforcement, legislation, feels that it is their spot to come in with the inevitable overreach and lack of understanding that will happen about what protocols are and what they can do? And I understand that decisions were made before. for the IETF not to be involved in these kinds of things, or even a discussion of balance as to whether there are legitimate needs for inspection of traffic, or for, heaven forbid, law enforcement. And I will say, I mean, you know, if my child is in danger, as far as I'm concerned, you can look at whatever traffic from wherever else, you know, you want. I mean, that's my child. And so, as I say, that's I don't think that's an uncommon kind of a thing. So I just wonder if that's a conversation we want to have. Quite often, as Mike Bishop and others have said, if I even bring up something like that, people just say, that is not a discussion we want to have at the IETF.
Yeah, my name is Georg Meyer, and I have the fortunate role of being the liaison person between 3GPP and IETF on the 3GPP side, so thank you for bashing SA3LI. I don't participate in that group. I just wanted to say a few things on that. First of all, 3GPP is set up in a very different way than here. This is a community of individuals. 3GPP is set up by the organizational partners, which are practically the national standards bodies. So you can't expect the same sort of discussions even being possible in such a group than here. But I agree, we don't discuss ethics or anything like that. And what we do is we adopt an enormous amount of IETF work. And we had long discussions on specific IETF rules and ways of doing protocols, what they demand from the protocols. The end-to-end principle, for example, is always quite hard for us to digest. But the digestion always brings forward good things, I think, that make the work progress in a positive way. So I think if you don't have this discussion here, then others will not have it. This is a good place for having discussions on human rights, on how we want to shape technology in an ethical way. And I think it's necessary to do it here. It will be, in one way or the other, adopted by other communities, and you will spread this like a virus, practically, to others. So I don't see a reason why this shouldn't be discussed here. Thank you.
Matt Mathis, I think we're already playing on a very tilted playing field that is tilted to our severe disadvantage, mostly because the dominant behaviors today are determined by bugs. Either oversights and applications are outright bugs in end systems, and we have no way of retiring buggy systems, and the response to the collateral damage from these bugs is actually going to force authorities to do things that we really don't want them to do and would not be necessary if the bugs were fixed. I really think that fixing some of these problems and finding ways of removing buggy systems from the internet is actually, it's a crucial policy problem that we really need to address. It sounds like we've also reached the point where we need to maybe think about whether 2804 needs to be nuanced some and reopened in some way. Thank you.
Carrie Lynn. Philip referenced the recent election that we had here in the States. I'm not sure that I've heard the internet mentioned before in other elections to the extent that it was this time, from hacked emails, fake news, disinformation to dissuade people from voting. I know this is the IETF and we don't talk about applications here. I guess I'm curious to know whether you have any evidence of other groups considering this from a network application perspective, such as social media, number one. And number two, do we even have the technology or the ability to detect how the internet is tilting the playing field? Thank you.
You guys want to respond?
I have two answers. One's cynical. I asked the same question of a friend of mine. Well, who speaks for the application designers? To which the answer was Google. And I wasn't sure I liked that answer, but I actually think we made a mistake in the very early days of the design of the internet. We basically stayed away from applications because we knew that we had no control over the designers, and why would they listen to us? So we didn't bother to speak to them. And I actually think maybe that was a mistake. I've tossed around a phrase, and I've heard other people use it too, that we could actually help application designers not by telling them what to do, but by giving them what I've been calling application design patterns, which is to say, by the way, if you do this, you don't have to think it through from scratch. And you know, some obvious examples are, you know, I honestly believe that the internet as a packet carriage layer should not be defining how we manage human level identity. There are people who say that packets should have human level identity in them in a bolted in way. I think it's very socially a very bad idea. But if every application designer has to design an identity scheme from scratch, in many cases it'll end up being flawed. So why don't we help people out? And I think you could have a group whose goal is to look at how applications have been built, to learn from them, and to come up with best practices. Even though we know we can't force them on people, they might just listen to us. So I think we probably have more coherence and more cohesion here than any other group that I know of that deals with applications. But if that's not true, we really ought to work with them.
It's always easy to look at the problems somewhere else and not look at your own problem. So indeed, there are a lot of issues on the application layer. But within our work, as has been rightfully pointed out, we still have got a lot of work to do. And this is relevant for political situations in many countries around the world, relevant to internet shutdowns in Cameroon, relevant to eavesdropping in other countries. So I think we should we realize now that the internet is mediating rights in all parts of the world, and therefore we should respond to the to see how we can make the internet a rights enabling network all over the world, and not just here or there, but also address this as we've done as a global community.
Last word.
I appear to be the last one, Bron Gondwana. I have opinions. I wanted to talk about tilting playing fields and unintended consequences. When cars got better security systems, they didn't stop being stolen. People started carjacking, and the injury rates and death rates of the car owners went up because they were being attacked while they were in their cars rather than their cars being stolen otherwise. The people we're trying to protect against with security policies have real-world power. They have real-world ability to enforce things. If we mandate that somebody unlocks their phone with a duress finger that suddenly makes it that it appears that they don't have data on there that they actually had on there, and there's no way of knowing whether you unlocked it with a duress finger, does this mean that every single person who unlocks their phone is assumed guilty because there's no way of knowing? And similarly with protocols that block out people with real power, they will find a way around the protocol. As the internet routes around blockage as censorship, people with power will route around our protocols as censorship of their power. And that's something we need to consider when we're tilting the playing field in a direction. Who else is going to be damaged by protecting the ones that we are protecting?
That sounds like a tussle.
It is a tussle.
Thank you all very much. Do you want to respond to that at all? That sounds. I appreciate the conversation we've had here today. It sounds like we've gotten some useful feedback, and there's interest in the room. Obviously, conversation continues in HRPC, and everyone is welcome to participate there. Open research group, and I get the impression from you that not only are you working on documents, but you want to come back to the IETF in the future and talk about specifically. You know, more specific things that we should be doing and ways to apply that work in the IETF future work. With that, I want to again thank our speakers and go on to the next item on our agenda.
Could I ask the outgoing IEB members to join me on stage? And while they're making their way up, I've been reassured by the Jabber chat room that the applications and real-time area was not closed down. So if you're working in that area, please show up at your working groups tomorrow as expected. Thank you.
You come.
Yari, Sorry, dude, you agreed to re-up. Bye.
Yes.
For those of you who don't know, Yari was formerly on the IEB as IETF chair, stood for and was appointed by the NOMCOM as a member of the IEB, so he doesn't really get to stay with us. Lars, why don't you join us first? Please stand up.
All right.
So, for those of you who don't know, the IRTF chair is also a member of the IEB, and in respect of his research focus, we thought, what could we give him that would sort of represent that? And we decided on a lab coat. But really, a lab coat wasn't going to do him justice. He's really represented a free-thinking attitude toward the IRTF, in particular his motto of act like an IRSG and you are one, really struck us as the right way to go. And so we present you with this tie-dyed lab coat in consideration of all of your help. Thank you very much. I'm also allowed to hold up a fake plaque for him to hold just for a moment so that a picture can be taken. The actual plaque will be sent to you at your home.
So people will forever confuse me with Spencer now if I wear this.
So gosh, I'm going to actually do this in order of term of service on the IEB, which means, Ralph, I think you're next. So one of the odd things about the IEB is we take people who are technical experts in a particular field and we make them wear about a million different hats. They have to be diplomats, they have to be liaison managers, they have to reach out into different communities. And so we thought, what better way to represent this than by presenting you an adventure hat for whatever adventures follow you on the IEB. Thank you, Ralph, for all your time.
Thank you.
Example.
It literally says your name here. And I believe the NOMCOM would like me to reinforce that your name could be here if you go and find Peter Yi and his cohort very soon now. Okay, Andrew, come up on now.
Dr. Hoffman, I presume.
So, Andrew... Andrew also deserves to wear many different hats because in addition to serving as an IEB member, he also served as an IEOC member, as a member of the IESG, as I would say our nominee to be stucky on every single IANA transition committee we could find. The IEB has told me that I have to clear things with them before I say them out loud because I have this tendency to say things sort of emotional. And in this regard, they told me in particular I was not allowed to throw my arms around Andrew's legs on stage and beg him not to go when it is so obvious he would be so much better staying than going. But we have appreciated the 14 years of service you gave in the past four. Many, many thanks.
Well, thank you very much, and I really wanted to say one thing in particular. I appreciated the support and everything from my colleagues, but I also really super appreciated the support from Cindy Morgan, who is some kind of organizational genius and without whom I would have died over the past 2 years. So thank you very much.
This plaque is the example.com of awards. So the next interesting thing I have to report is we have a tie because both Russ and Dave joined the IEB at exactly the same time 10 years ago. I'm going to ask Dave to come up first because Russ was on the IESG before he joined the IEB, and I'm sure there were some IEB meetings he was in as a result of that. So Dave, would you come up now? Thank you very much for everything.
don't leave, because for those of you who have never been one of the readers of his 50-odd RFCs or in a working group with him, Dave has an encyclopedic knowledge of the IETF and of IAB procedures, and we have looked to him countless times over the time I've been back on the IAB as the source of truth. And I have to say that this morning he demonstrated that it was actually an encyclopedic knowledge of damn near everything when he was correcting Niels Ten Over on the Magna Carta. So, frankly, you can forget Google, even though they pay my salary. If you have a question, please ask Dave. There's no way this hat is big enough for Russ's head. We're going to try it. Oh, it actually does work. So Russ has had a dot on his badge for 14 years, which is somewhat astonishing to all of us who can't imagine surviving this more than about 2 weeks straight. I certainly know this morning when I got the 6:30 wake-up call, I was like, 14 years? How did that guy do that? Over the past 10 years, he's served the IEB first as IETF chair, and then as a member. He was also the IEB chair. And let me just say, if there's a job that has been done in the IETF, Russ Housley has certainly put his hand to it at some point. Thank you very much, Russ. The good news is you'll get to see them one more time when the IAB comes up for open mic, because we continue to have our IAB members through the entire week. But thank you. We'll see you up again in just a few minutes. It looks great on you.
And then the IAC, Leslie.
Benson, where art thou? Come on up. We have a somewhat simpler procedure at this point, since we have a lower turnover rate. So while he's walking up, I will say that I am, wish Benson good luck and happy future adventures in the IETF and beyond. I'm sorry to see he is leaving the IAOC, certainly our loss. So I'd like to thank Benson very much for his tenure on the IAOC.
And now it's IST's turn, so if we can get Joel, Stephen, and also Alyssa and Kathy on stage. So Joel and Stephen, I wanted to thank you so much for your efforts in the IETF, in the ISG. And Joel, we often in the IETF and ISG in particular, we end up in some kind of a problem or panic mode. Oh my God, what are we going to do? There's always one person who has his feet on the ground, his understanding of the ground reality in networking and what actually happens out there in the internet has been spectacular. And that has helped us see what we actually need to do and not get overly excited or have any kind of problem. So I want to thank you for that. Thank you for your service. And Stephen, you've been the person, in my mind at least, who's like the one who's fighting the most for security of the internet, privacy of the internet users, and always keeping that in mind. And I remember when we understood the scale of the Snowden revelations, how you went straight ahead and started addressing that. What can we do? What can we help? And you worked very hard. I think the security of the internet, the privacy of the users has improved because of our actions here at the IETF and your actions. So thank you for that. And I am also stepping down, and I just wanted to say a few words, not too long, don't worry. We'll get to the open mic session soon. Just to say thank you. Thank you for allowing me to join this journey with you. And thank you for Alissa and for the new ADs to take on your new roles. The IETF is in very good hands with you. I do have a couple of takeaways. One is that it's difficult to predict what will happen. As an example, Snowden revelations, they were a surprise, I think. But more importantly, if you look at the things that we've done, let's say the three things that are on my mind right now is improvements on security, IANA transition, and the developments in web protocols, HTTP2, TLS 1.3, QUIC, and so forth. What's common with this is that if we put our collective minds to it, we put our effort to it, we can actually make substantial things, substantial changes happen. So we can have an impact, a major impact, tilt the playing field, if we can borrow a phrase from the previous discussion. And I think I've been lucky to be along for the ride, to see as these things have been made and the changes are being made. I think we all have been lucky that we can witness these changes being happening. And I know that we can do this again. We will do it in the future. We can believe in ourselves that we can make these things happen. We can do the right thing. And I think the future is bright. So with that, thank you.
You're not getting off that easy. So, like, the crazy thing about this picture is the suit, right? It's it's not the suit on skis, but certainly the suit. So I wanted to take a few minutes to talk a little bit about my dear colleague, Yari, and give him a proper thank you. I know you all are feeling that the plenary isn't long enough, but wanted to spend a few minutes to acknowledge his contributions to this community. In the IETF leadership, we often talk about burnout, and you'll hear people say, you know, should I do a second term or a third term? I'm getting into my fifth or sixth year, and man, when ADs do that, they get really cranky and start putting all these discusses on the documents, and, you know, we should really avoid this burnout situation. And by all accounts, Yari is well past where he should have burnt out. He's been participating in the IETF for more than 20 years. He has just completed his 11th consecutive year in the IETF leadership. He's been a prolific RFC author. He's been a huge supporter of IETF innovations like the hackathon. He's really deepened relationships with sponsors, with other internet organizations, even with government officials, maybe something that he never thought he was going to do. And what's remarkable is that he basically has more enthusiasm and energy for this work now than he ever has. He's completely relentless. And I wanted to illustrate this using a little example. So last March, Yari traveled to Morocco for an ICANN meeting. And his schedule was basically that he was going to be at the ICANN meeting for a week in Morocco, then he was going to California for the IoT Semantic Interoperability Workshop, a couple days off, then he was going to go to Buenos Aires for IETF 95. And at this particular ICANN meeting, in addition to the usual kinds of conversations you would expect about DNS technology and policy, he had this little project that people had been working on for 2 or 10 or 15 years, depending on how you want to count. We were trying to finish up the IANA transition. And this was actually the meeting where we finished the proposal. And so all of that week, Yari was incredibly instrumental in getting that thing done. And you know, you've all seen him do it in the IETF, but what's impressive is that he can do the same thing kind of anywhere with any crowd of technology people or non-technology people. He was reasonable and measured. He brought us together behind consensus positions. He helped negotiate different people's interests behind the scenes and in the public discussion. And he did it all without ever compromising on the core values that we were trying to hold to in that process. And so we spent the whole week kind of hammering out the details of this proposal. And you can kind of think about it like an IETF week. And you know, you think about how you feel at the end of the IETF week, except with this sort of grimy layer of politics on top. That's sort of how I felt at the end of a lot of these ICANN meetings. And so if you think about how you feel at the end of the week, I know that usually I'm exhausted at the end of one of these things, ready to go home and take a nap. That's not exactly what Yari did. Yari took a day-long taxi ride to the Atlas Mountains so that he could go skiing. Not a big surprise. He loves to ski, but, you know, it is the end of a long week. So he gets up there, and he decides to get up this slope that you can see in the picture. He's going to ride a horse up the mountain and then ski down. So he's got his ski boots on, riding up the horse, riding up the mountain. And unfortunately, the horse was not being particularly cooperative that day and decided halfway up the mountain that he was having none of it. So started bucking, running around. Yari gets flung off the horse, but that ski boot that you can see is caught in the stirrup. So here's this horse on this mountain dragging Yari back and forth, freaking out. And you know, when he comes to, he stands up and he looks down and he's got these horseshoe-shaped bruises on his front and back, thinking to himself, like, maybe I broke my ribs. Like, this is really painful. Again, like, if you somehow ended up in this situation, what would you do? Call for help? Maybe ask this guide if he can take you down on his horse? He already skied down the mountain. The guy is relentless, right, in every aspect of his life. So he goes to the doctor in Morocco, and lo and behold, broken his ribs. He was right. Says thank you very much, gets on his flight, which he had to stop over in London, supposed to be on his way to California for the workshop, decides to get a second opinion in London, and they say, you know, really shouldn't get on that plane to California. It's not a good idea. Sit on a plane for that long with a bunch of broken ribs and internal injuries. What would your reaction be? Your reaction would probably be, man, I am in a lot of pain. It would be nice to go home, just take a little break before I have to go to a third continent for a meeting that I have to run. You know, maybe a little bit of relief, actually, like, okay, I can actually take a little break. This is a direct quote from Yari's blog. His reaction, very unhappy that I didn't get to go to my super interesting workshop. And this, again, like, totally typifies him.
I called in.
You called in. Why didn't I have a picture of that? Come on. That's awesome. So, there's this problem out there on the internet. We have all these IoT devices. They don't understand what on is and off is when they're talking to each other. There's a bunch of really smart people who are going to get together and try to figure out, can we conceptualize this problem in a way that we could meaningfully advance the standards work? And that's going to be super interesting, and I really want to be there, and I can't go, and I'm very unhappy. No matter that I just finished the IANA transition, skied down a mountain with broken ribs. But nevertheless, 10 days later, shows up in Buenos Aires, unbeknownst to anyone, with recovering from these injuries and this ordeal, and you wouldn't have known any different. He was back to the grind, doing the same thing that he's been doing in this organization and elsewhere for decades now, building consensus, rallying all of us behind him, being like utterly the most reasonable, optimistic, positive person in the room, and just giving everything he can to try to bring out the best ideas and the most fruitful collaborations in this community, again, relentlessly. So I know we already thanked you, but I'm gonna ask everyone to stand up and thank Yari again for his dedication to the IETF and his service. So the members of the ISG who served on you with you as chair got together a few small gifts, tokens of our appreciation. First, we have a sports watch. We expect that you will have more time to ski, a little bit more time to ski these days. And we heard that you might be in need of a new watch, so that's for you.
Thank you.
And we also heard that it might be fun for you to have this guy follow you around on all of your future adventures. So we got you a drone. And I will say, there were several of us who wanted to fly the drone in, but there were several others of us who advised that that might not be a good idea. So you can take it up with them if you want to fly it around the rest of the week, but we chose to go the safer path and just deliver it by hand.
Thank you. And I hope this drone will rescue me from difficult situations, like if the horse is, doing something bad, or the plenary is difficult.
I think ISOC has a gift to present to you as well. So, Kathy, come on up.
So, nothing like what you just said, but I want to just say that, I got one for you too, Andrew, over here, and one for you over here. And while we wanted to get Andrew something very sophisticated, like a very expensive pen, we didn't, we got him this gift certificate. And while we wanted to get something very expensive for you, like here, we did it, we got a gift certificate. But here's the deal. We went through 3 years putting IANA together with this bunch of people defending what could have gone down in a horrible, horrible disaster at the end of last year by the skin of our teeth and the dedication of 1, 2, 3, and many other people. It got done and it's made a big difference. We may not be really focusing on that today, but the world would be different right now had we not done that. So do our best, or your best. No stupid little hack from us. Don't know. And one, I got to get you one too.
So there's some really big boots to fill. I really wanted those to be ski boots, but no one has built giant ski boots apparently for this purpose. There's an idea. Yari has his next project. So I really desperately want to get to the open mics, but wanted to just take 1 minute to talk a little bit about the future. What I can say is that I am really deeply honored to have been selected to serve the community as the next IETF chair, particularly given how significant the IETF's contributions to the internet and to the world have been. I think we have a lot of fun and challenging work ahead of us, whether that's based on new technologies, IoT, virtualization, security, so many new things coming down the pike, or whether we're talking about evolving the way we work, how people participate, how we administer and fund the IETF. I think in this community, we have the smarts and the passion and the dedication to get it all done. And that's one of the reasons why I love working here. In particular, I'm pretty excited about the opportunities and the challenges that are presented to us by the melding of old and new. We have a lot of people who have been working here at the IETF basically since the beginning of the internet. We have a lot of people who have shown up for the first time. We also have, you know, principles and ideas that are extremely well established, and we have some pressures and tensions that are causing us to maybe rethink some of those principles. We have companies that have been around since the beginning, and we have startups that are still in stealth mode and people who are working across the spectrum of all of those organizations. And I think the challenge for us is to figure out how we stay true to the core of what we do here and making the internet work better while adapting to all of these changes and thinking about how we can evolve as a community, as an important force in the future of the internet. So that's one aspect that I'm particularly excited about working on. If you have thoughts about how to make the internet work better, how to make the IETF work better for you or for other people who aren't here, I would love to hear them. My contact info is there. You guys know where to find me. And I would say, don't be shy, but I know that you won't be shy. And with that, I would like to ask the IAB to come to the stage, outgoing, continuing, incoming. We're going to do IAB open mic first.
So need to continue.
Yeah, I said.
All right, so two of them will be by this. Beautiful color.
It's, you want it?
God, that's bright.
Oh, that is bright.
Jeez,
there are four lights.
So we'll start by introducing the IAB. Martin, would you begin?
Martin Thompson, continuing.
Thank you, Martin.
Dave Thaler, outgoing.
Andrew Sullivan, outgoing.
Oh, shit.
Allison Menken, incoming IRTF.
Noriel Montenegro, incoming.
Eric Nordmark, continuing.
Russ Housley, outgoing.
Suzanne Wolf, continuing.
Alyssa Cooper, incoming.
Brian, would you introduce yourself?
Brian Trammell, continuing.
And I think we have one more person in queue. If I'm going to press the button again, Brian.
He's gone.
Mark, you should get in queue now. I'm going to go on down.
Yari Arco, incoming IAB.
Joe Hildebrand, continuing.
Robert Sparks, continuing.
Lars Eggert, outgoing IRTF.
Jeff Nansura, incoming.
Heather Flanagan, not exactly on the IAB.
Lee Howard, continuing.
And Ralph Drums, doffing his hat on the way out the door.
So the person who may eventually turn up on that screen will be Mark Nottingham, one of our other, oh, are you ready? Oh, not in queue yet, but we'll press the button when he is. And I'm Ted Hardy, continuing. So the mic lines are open if you have questions or comments for the Internet Architecture Board. If you have them for the Internet Advertising Board, we can give you their URL.
But we have an email address.
Seeing none,
we're done.
We thank you for your attention, and the next group can come up.
So next we have the IOC, the trust.
We're missing some people. I think the outgoing don't want to show their faces. Hi. Yeah. Oh, yeah, Ted. All right.
I was just checking on Mark to make sure a horse hadn't gotten him.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I'll start with the introductions. Ted, if you could start.
I'm still Ted Hardy.
Carver Reinsberg, incoming IOC.
Kathy Brown.
John Levine.
Ray Pelletier.
Lou Berger.
Alyssa Cooper.
Still Leslie Daigle.
Yari Ark already taken off the IOC list.
Tobias Gondrum, outgoing IETF chair, IETF Trust Chair, and I just wanted to mention over there is Kaveh, who is our new IETF Trust Chair.
So before we get to the open mics, what I wanted to do was first thank Tobias for having served in this past year as IETF Trust Chair. If we can... and then Kaveh, if you'd like to say a couple words just to introduce yourself as the new IETF Trust Chair.
Thank you. So hello, in my day job, I am the CIO at RIPE-NCC, which means I'm the senior manager in charge of budgeting and running all of our measurement services, including RIPE Atlas, RIS, and RIPE Stat, as well as all of our DNS operations, including KRoot. I'm also, because I operate KRoot, I'm an RSEC in ICANN, and I'm also the RSEC liaison to the ICANN board. So these are my responsibilities. I work with budgets and numbers regularly, and I hope I can serve the IOC and the trust.
Thank you. All right. Any questions for the IOC, IAD, or IETF trust? Going once. Going twice. Next up.
Thank you.
Okay, could we have the ISG to the stage, please? Outgoing, continuing, and incoming. Make sure you sit with your co-ADs so you can pass stats.
There you go.
What?
Just the juice of a few flowers.
I'll find you.
There's no chair.
Yeah, there's, are there not enough chairs?
No chairs.
Lee, or somebody on the end there, do you think you could provide us with another chair, please? Thank you.
I have another one.
The art area really is disappearing.
I know, I'm fine.
Bonus round. Okay. Let's start down here. With, introduce yourself.
Eric Prescorla, incoming security.
Ted Hardy.
Stephen Farrell, escaping security.
Ben Campbell, continuing art.
Aaliyah Atlas, continuing routing.
Spencer Dawkins, continuing transport.
Mia Kulivan, continuing transport.
Terry Manderson, continuing interior.
Alexei Melnikov, continuing application in real time.
Eliza Cooper, incoming IETF chair. And outgoing art.
Yariak, outgoing chair.
Suresh Krishnan, continuing internet.
Benoit Claes, ops.
Deborah Brungard, continuing routing.
Oren Kumari, incoming ops.
Joel Yegley, ex ops.
Kathleen Moriarty, continuing security.
Alberto Retana, continuing routing.
Adam Roach, incoming art.
Okay, so time to pass your dots. If you need extra dots, you can't get your dot off. I have dots for you, so.
Done already.
Yeah, you need that.
No, we're done. We did it.
Hmm?
We figured it out.
You already did it? Yeah, okay, yeah. Dots have been passed. All right, questions at the mic for the ISG?
John Clenson, it wouldn't be fair to close one of these meetings without at least one question.
Thank you for if you want to know where to get the sweet way.
And I have no comments about cookies, but I do have a question. It was mentioned in the context of the NOMCOM report, but there's a broader issue, which is that when we put together qualifications for various things, we put them together on the basis of using the NOMCOM 3 out of 5 rule for everything we thought of. And in addition to NOMCOM issues there, that rule applies to initiating recalls. And while we have never used that procedure to its full extent, and I hope we never will, as remote participation increases, we're running the risk of unfairness by a situation which says that somebody who is participating remotely cannot initiate a recall if they feel like there's unfair treatment justifying it. The last time this issue came up was some years ago, and the IESG had no interest in dealing with it. Is the IESG willing to take that on now?
I mean, yes, our NOMCOM liaison would like to respond. Our previous NOMCOM liaison.
We had a discussion in ISG that we would like to update various NOMCOM procedures. I made a foolish mistake of volunteering to be AD sponsoring some of the documents, and that might be one of the issues that we'll consider.
Okay, again, I applaud your looking at the NOMCOM procedures, but my specific interest is other things which are tied to NOMCOM qualification, which may need separate review.
Yeah, I believe there is a draft, and it might be expired at the moment. But so,
okay, thank you. Look.
Good point.
Yeah, so I think we have an existence proof of the initiation of IETF recall procedures, and it turns out, at least from my vantage point as somebody who signed up to support that. Because you have actually signed on to a recall, you cannot be considered for the committee that would then consider the recall. So it's probably pretty easy to find 8 people who don't want to be on that committee within the IETF, which I think actually makes that problem not a huge one. I think the existential question around is non-com eligibility a problem
with respect to how we choose our leadership, and is actually a rather important one, because if we're all remote, then we can't actually choose anyone, and we have no one to serve on the NOMCOM, and I think those are very serious problems. I think the recall procedure, however, looks like it has an escape clause there. It does, absolutely. You can find 8 people to do that.
Unless my memory has gone completely bad, it's no longer 8.
So this is Spencer. Just in general, the ISG is spending a lot of time thinking about what we can do to improve the remote participation experience. This falls under that, in my opinion. I don't know what the answer we would come up with would be, but I don't think it's out of scope, but I think we should be looking at it.
Any other questions? Going once, going twice. I think we're done. Thank you. Enjoy your evening.
That's never happened before.
Never.
No.
See if anybody got more
questions.
Yeah, maybe.
I like that.
Because we're doing a terrific job. Ask anybody.
You're an optimist. You've been doing a perfect job for a long time, and it has nothing to do with whether or not they're not.